Welcome to this keynote controversy, What's God Got to Do with It? My name's Michael Fitzpatrick. I'm an Irish Catholic by tribal origins and an atheist by conviction and a doctor by trade. Just to put my cards on the table. Nietzsche said God is dead in 1862, but it is striking that God does seem to resurrect himself with remarkable efficiency in every decade since then and remains a central issue of cultural, social, political controversy. It was brought home to me recently, I don't know if anybody noticed, there's been this new exhibition opened in Reading Jail about the Oscar Wilde imprisonment there, notoriously in the end of the 1890s. You'll also notice that Oscar Wilde's one of the people who hasn't got exonerated in the proposed legislation to retrospectively exculpate people guilty of such crimes. But I was talking to somebody about the exhibition, and there was some discussion about the poem, the letter that Oscar Wilde wrote to his former lover, Lord Alfred Douglas, that led to him being incarcerated in the first place. And the letter was famously entitled De Profundis. And I was talking to this old friend of mine about it, and she said to me just casually, by the way, you know, you're somebody who knows a bit of Latin. What does De Profundis mean? And I thought, you know, this triggered in me almost a sort of hindbrain memory straight, you know, from more than 50 years ago. De Profundis, out of the depths have I cried unto thee, O Lord. Lord, hear my voice. Lord, be attentive to my suffering. You know, it's Psalm 130, which I learnt by heart in primary school. From the morning until night, let Israel hope in the Lord. It's the beautiful poetry of the Psalms. And it just occurred to me that there's a certain cultural loss in a society now that that term, when it was used, applied to Wilde's letter, would have been universally recognised in British society. Now it would scarcely, I doubt if even in the faith schools now to be reintroduced, anybody will be learning about the De Profundis. But it seems to me something that when you just hear the beauty of the poetry of the Psalms, you think, what a cultural loss that is. Or is it? Does it make any difference? Will the revival of the faith schools make any difference to that? Does it make any difference to the quality of life in society that those central motifs of the whole Judeo-Christian tradition are now increasingly out of public memory? We've got a panel here to discuss some of these issues. Just to introduce them very briefly in the firing order in which they're going to speak, Tim Crane going to speak first. He's a professor of philosophy at Cambridge. He's going to be followed by Ken Macleod on my right. He's an award-winning author, particularly working in the field of science fiction. Mona Siddiqui on the far right is a professor of Islamic studies at the University of Edinburgh. And John Waters on my far left is a well-known journalist and author, particularly well-known writing in the Irish media. So can you welcome all our speakers, and we'll start off to hear what they've got to say. Oh, I forgot our very own Dolan Cummings of the Institute of Ideas, who has sponsored this whole discussion, as is he. And is himself the author of a forthcoming novel, which I urge you all to get out there and find as soon as it's published. Tim.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Michael. What's God Got to Do with It? I'm going to focus on a rather general interpretation of that question. I'm a philosopher. Like Michael, I'm an atheist, but I'm a former Roman Catholic. And the interpretation of this question I'm going to focus on is, what's God got to do with religion? And it seems to me that the answer to that question is more complex than many people assume. If you follow the contemporary debate about religion between sparked off by the so-called new atheists, people like Richard Dawkins, they would answer the question, what's God got to do with religion? They'd answer the question by saying a lot, or almost everything. I mean, Dawkins' celebrated book is called The God Delusion, and he thinks of the task of an atheist is to attack this hypothesis that there is a God. I want to say that there's a very striking thing about this debate between the so-called new atheists and those who try and defend religion in our culture today, which is that people talk past each other all the time. No progress is made. No one is persuaded by any of these points. The religious people think that their views are being travestied, misrepresented. The atheists think that the religious are irrational and responsible for all the evils in the world, and so on. So I'm sure you're familiar with this sort of impasse that there is in this debate. I think this impasse comes from a misrepresentation of what the essence of religion is. And since I'm a philosopher, I'm talking at a rather abstract level that I hope I can make more concrete if people want to press me on things. The way that the new atheists think of religion, the essence of religion, it seems to me, is that they think of it, that religion is fundamentally a cosmology. That is to say, it's a theory of the universe. It's a theory about where the universe comes from, who made it, and what keeps it in shape. I think that this conception of religion is wrong in at least two ways. The first way is that to the extent that there is, I think, cosmological elements in religious belief, those cosmological elements are nothing like a theory of the world in the sense that Dawkins tries to present it as. The second way is, I think, that this picture of religion ignores what is perhaps the most obvious and striking fact about religion, which is that religions are things that people belong to. As Durkheim said many years ago, religion isn't something that you just believe, it's something you belong to. And belonging to a religion means doing certain things. If you look, for example, at the famous, the five pillars of Islam, these are, that there is no God but Allah and Muhammad is his prophet, and there is the injunction to give alms, there is the injunction to go on the pilgrimage, to fast, and to pray. Only one of those is a cosmological claim, and the other's about practice. In fact, so most of the essence of religion, it seems to me, is about a certain kind of practice that comes from a certain kind of belonging. The belonging I call identification, which is something which is familiar to us in all sorts of areas of our experience of the world. But this is something which is at the heart of religion. At the heart of religion is something which is deeply human, not something which, as the atheists represent it, is some kind of irrational perversion. In my view about the essence of religion, I would sum it up in two elements. One is what I call the religious impulse. The religious impulse, I could sum up by saying that it's the sense that this isn't all there is. This isn't all there is to it. This world that we see around us, all this stuff, there must be more to it than all this. That's the spiritual vision that lies at the heart of the great world religions. Now that is not anything like a scientific hypothesis, and there are so many different ways in which it differs from a scientific hypothesis, which we could talk about if you like. So that's the first element, what I call the religious impulse. Now, the religious impulse is largely missing from today's secular Britain, which is why we might ask about the place of religion in society. But today's secular Britain is a very small part of the world, of the world's 7 billion people. According to the Pew Research Center, around 6 billion identifies for some religion or other. So I think the picture that we get from secular Britain or secular London is a very partial picture of the world as a whole. That's because of the second feature that I want to identify, which is the element of identification in religion, that religion involves belonging to something and doing things in the way that they've been done for many years or centuries or millennia. So it's those two elements which I think are the essence of religious belief, the religious impulse, as I'm calling it, and the element of identification or belonging. What links those two things, I think, is the idea of a religious practice. A religious practice is something where people try and make contact both with things that transcend the ordinary world of experience and also with others to whom they belong, with the people who have said those words that are sometimes only partially understood, like the example that Michael was saying at the beginning. People who've been saying these words for hundreds of years. You connect to those people while also attempting to talk or talk in ways that connect you also with the transcendent. This seems to me to be the way in which religious practice unites both the religious impulse and the sense of belonging or identification. Now, I'm not a religious person myself. I'm looking at this from the outside. But I think if atheists do want to understand the phenomenon of religion and what role it plays in people's lives, and if they are at all baffled by the fact that no one is persuaded by the arguments of Richard Dawkins, then they should try and get a more realistic view of what the essence of religion is.
Thank you, Tim. Thank you. Ken.
Thank you. I'm going to start with a quote from one of the great moral thinkers of our time, Bono. I went into a church house where the citizens like to sit. They say they want the kingdom, but they don't want God in it. That's from their song, The Wanderer, U2 song, The Wanderer, which I've always found a very moving song and very strange, and it relates to aspects of a certain Protestant and sectarian mentality. I went out walking with the Bible and the gun, which I very much come from originally. I'm unlike the two previous speakers. I'm a Protestant by tribe, in fact, a Presbyterian, and but like them, I'm an atheist by conviction. And I have been interested in thinking back over how the register, if you like, of the atheist religion dialogue or debate has changed over the course of my lifetime. It's, as far as I know, in English, there were only two mass market paperbacks published on this topic of atheism between 1970 and 2000. These were basically Marxist works, one by Joachim Kahl called The Misery of Christianity, another by a Czech philosopher called God Is Not Yet Dead, very apt title. And the interesting thing, looking back at what was going on in the 1960s and 70s when I was growing up and becoming aware of these issues, was that most of the atheists who were arguing and the church people who were arguing were singing from the same hymn sheet, in the sense that they shared an enormous amount of common ground in terms of both political and moral outlook, I would say, on a lot of issues, but also on what they took as settled scientific critical thinking had been settled. Way back in the 19th century and a little earlier, the Christian and Jewish scriptures were subjected to what was called the higher criticism and were exposed pretty definitively, I think, as human productions, you know. It wasn't God who wrote that book, you know. It was people, mostly men, who wrote that book and wrote these books and these texts and so on, and they were put together and edited and collated, etc. And nowadays, almost all the mainstream churches will accept that. And likewise, the geologists and Darwin had established the age of the earth and evolution and so on. And all of these things were completely uncontentious between the people who were arguing about religion back in the 60s and 70s in any kind of big public way. And I found this a little bit baffling because, having been raised a fundamentalist, what I had to do was sort of dig back a little further back into the past to the old Rationalist Press Association's Thinkers Library and read Darwin and Haeckel and all the old rationalists for myself and get to get a handle on this religion thing. But all of that seemed to be going on underground, and fundamentalism was a very much a minority thing in all religious traditions, including in Islam, as far as most people understood what was going on. And in 2001, it was like an iceberg had hit the Titanic. And what you got, I think what new atheism came from, was basically the Al-Qaeda attacks plus American scientific creationism. 9/11 plus creationism gives you new atheism, because all these fundamentalists that we had been ignoring all that time, the secular liberal majority suddenly found that one lot of them were flying airliners into our skyscrapers, and the other lot were raising armies of infant trolls to attack their science lessons. And no wonder the Richard Dawkins gets apoplectic about fundamentalism. That's where the people who are constantly sabotaging science education in the United States come from. Now, of course, in a wider kind of, I think, materialist perspective, this whole suddenly reignited debate, this incredibly vulgar-seeming debate between militant atheists and, in most cases, Christian fundamentalists, that's how the debate has been fought out here, going at it hammer and tongs, and slightly above the fray and to one side, the good bishops of the Church of England and so forth, stepping back and going, what? Well, they're not quite going WTF, but they're thinking, what is all this about? This unseemly dust-up has nothing to do with anything that we would regard as religious practice or whatever. And likewise, a lot of people on the left, particularly the part of the left influenced by Marxism, have been appalled by it, and no wonder. Because what I think is really interesting in terms of the materialist understanding of religion is that religion is seen entirely as a form of social consciousness. It's something that human beings created within the world of within their social worlds. And likewise, as the old rationalist press associations, I think it was membership card, used to say, morality is social in origin and application. So morality and religion are both social, and they're both in the same territory, as it were, the same ontological territory. And what they mean together is, what all this means together is, there's nobody here but us. We are the ones who make the rules. And that's actually a quite terrifying insight. And it's no wonder that people want to offload it and outsource it to some external source of authority, whether it be God or science or the established way of thinking or whatever. However, I am a little wary of some of the framing of the question as it's been put in the rubric for this session, like talking about PC received opinion and the science and all that kind of thing. I do think that facts matter and have to be brought into ethical and moral argument. Evidence matters. And finally, I would say, in terms of what we can do with instead of God, is the sheer otherness and the sheer outsideness, the objectivity of the universe. Actually, for people who are aware of it, it replaces God as a source of wonder, but it can't replace God as a source of guidance, but then nor can God. We've known ever since Plato that the question, I hope I'm pronouncing this right, I think it's the Euthyphro argument. The Euthyphro argument is one of Plato's dialogues where he asks the question, is something good because the gods approve it, or do the gods approve it because it's good? And whichever way you answer gets you into difficulty. But the basic answer that nearly everybody sensible will accept is that the gods approve it because it's good. Aha! Which means you know what good is, whether God tells you or not. So in that sense, God has nothing to do with it and never did.
Thank you, Ken. Beautifully timed. Mona Siddiqui.
Thank you. So since everyone is confessing to their belief, I am a Muslim by birth, by faith, and by tradition and culture. I actually have a script. I've tried to understand what the blurb of this session actually means. What has God got to do with our ethics? But I want to concentrate largely on the UK and our debates about religion and God in the UK. So in 1997, the historian Peter Clark made the observation that in the 20th century, Great Britain had lost its historic identity as a Protestant nation. This combined with various surveys which show a decline in the authority of institutional Christianity, but the rise of various minority faiths actually makes it very difficult to assess a nation's religious identity. It seems to me that in the UK, despite declining church membership and diminishing formal worship, the debate as to whether the UK is still largely a Christian country is still alive. Institutional religion has declined as a cohesive force, giving meaning and stability to the nation. Or as Charles Taylor puts it, religion has lost its public hold. But our calendar, our formal occasions, our legal system, our social and literary references, our cultural memory, all this is still largely rooted, even if many people are forgetting it, as our chair has said it, is still rooted in the context of Christianity. The larger point that religion, with all its complexities, still continues to be a central feature of human life, giving shape and meaning to our existence, is often lost in the frequent media debate contesting as to whether religion is a force for good or bad in the modern world. And we tend to measure religious belief through the prism of a largely secular Western Europe and forget, as has been said, that in the rest of the world, religious faith still has a hold over people, and that means that God has a hold over people's lives. The title of this panel, What's God Got to Do With It, is not the same as What's Religion Got to Do With It. Structured religion has been loosened, but however conceived, God remains a personal presence in people's lives in all kinds of ways. Our public conversations today are not so much about religion itself, but about the possible reach of religion in secular Western Europe, and how do we protect that perceived secular public space? Religion here is often seen as something that takes us back to an intolerant past, whereas secularism grounds us in individual freedom and pulls us towards a hopeful future. And in many ways, I can understand why. Secularity as a process has been successful. The rise of democratic rule, the concept of civil society, equality of all kinds under the state, the consciousness of human rights and individual freedoms have all accelerated the growth of secularism. And this means that in the case of the UK, a nation's moral consciousness is far less grounded in religion than it was only a generation ago. Our values are increasingly also based on individual human rights. Religion points to a world beyond the earthly struggle for rights. As such, it struggles to find meaning politically and socially, and for many, even personally. But it's also important to realize that faith in God is not simply about otherworldliness. It's about the moral imperative to make things better in the here and now, irrespective of hopes of salvation or redemption. So for many people, as Don Cupid said, the transcendent is in the here and now. It is true that we don't invoke God in most of our public debates, even in much of our ethical thinking. But I think that misses the point of history, that most people who do believe in God throughout history have struggled with how they can find and articulate new ways of keeping God alive in their lives, and God alive as a meaning. This is against a background of a world which no longer speaks of man seeking God as much as man seeking meaning after God. And finally, today our age is an age of uncertainty. Uncertainty is no longer a philosophical concern, which for some, like Soren Kierkegaard, was about the torments of religious questions, the awkwardness of human existence, which ultimately meant taking a leap of faith into the arms of God, whether or not you were sure he was there. The anguish of a bygone philosophical age is today apparent in the anxieties of certainty, uncertainty everywhere, in our relationships, in our professional lives, in our health, in our politics, in almost every area of our life. Technology and longevity has actually made us even more acutely aware of our frailty and our increased search for hope. To be human is to long and to search for hope. And for me, God lies somewhere in this search for hope. Thank you.
Thank you, Mona.
John.
To talk about God, we use the least inadequate words, the words which, you know, no words are capable. The word God is incapable of being defined or really even discussed in rationally or scientifically, even theologically. If you name God, if you describe God, you've got it wrong. I'm a lapsed agnostic. That means I've been in the territory that Mike and Ken describe themselves as walking through right now. I had my de profundis moment in alcoholism. And this is the point about this. You can have all kinds of intellectual, interesting, stimulating discussions about these subjects, but until you are living on the very edge of the abyss, staring into space and back into yourself, these issues don't really become real. They don't really become what they need to be understood by you subjectively in your heart. They can't be apprehended rationally. They can't be apprehended intellectually. They can only be apprehended in the experience that you're having and the limits that you discover in yourself at that moment. And this is really what God is, insofar as we can dare to speculate or to define. But we know what it's not. We know that, for example, we are not God. I am not God. You are not God. It's a good start. It sounds banal, but it's a really good place to start, because that's the big mistake we make. I mean, it's one thing not believing in God. It's another thing to start believing that you are God. And that's been the problem with our civilization. There are sort of different functions. I mean, as you can talk about God, you know, there are different ways we could discuss these questions. I mean, we could just pray at one end. But I don't know how many people would want to share in that. Perhaps not as many as 10, 20 years ago. At the other end, we could go all sociological. And all these have the elements of truth in them. And all, you know, it's not that one contradicts the other, because they're different planes of dealing with the subject. So we can actually, you know, talk about sociological. I'd like to talk a little bit about the sociological, because I think it's actually where our big error is being made. A lot of what is called rationalism in this, and I'm very wary of this word, because it's the rationalism of the box. It's the rationalism of this room. It's not the rationalism of the totality of reality. It's not the rationalism of the mystery that defines us, because there is no such thing as a rationalism of the mystery, by definition. So there are different functions in which religion has actually become useful in our societies. First of all, we can say that we, whether through evolution or not, and I will leave that question open, I don't offer an opinion on it, there may be evolutionary elements to it, that we have acquired a desire for something that might be defined as the infinite, that we have a desire for the infinite, and that nothing in this material world satisfies us, no matter what we do. That's alcoholism. I thought the answer to my life and meaning of my life could be found in a glass. I was wrong. And that's when I woke up to these questions, that there's something else. The Alcoholics Anonymous called the higher power. It's a kind of a psychological device, but it draws our attention to the nature of our structure, and that's important. We can talk about utilitarianism. There are lots of things that you can find religion and God and all that kind of useful. If you want to walk out to... My mother, when we were kids, teenagers, she used to have a great saying, which I think more and more as I grow older, it almost defines everything. When we'd be arsing around the place in the summer holidays looking for something to do, she'd say, "You don't know what to do with yourselves." Well, if you go out to the Millennium Bridge and do a 360-degree twirl, you'll see all kinds of buildings. You'll see cigar-shaped buildings. You'll see radiator-shaped buildings. You'll see salt cellar-shaped buildings. You'll see all kinds of buildings. And then you turn and you face St. Paul's. And there you see a 300-year-old building, which is actually beautiful, which will live for thousands and thousands of years unless it's bombed. But the radiators won't, and the salt cellars won't, and the cigars won't. That tells, I'm not making this cheap point, I'm making a point about the imagination of our species, because that's fundamentally what God is about. God is about the capacity to imagine the potential of everything, culturally, imaginatively. It's not a fixed meaning. Of course, in our culture and in the inadequacy of our words, and we have to create certain fixed sentences about it. But these sentences should be taken lightly, ironically, not clung to. But just because they can be rumbled by some smart arse like Richard Dawkins or the late Christopher Hitchens, with whom I debated, just because they can be, does not mean that they are untrue or that there is nothing behind them, or that there was no reason. No reason for them. No reason for them. Because reason is something greater than what we can see. We could all live in this room for the next 20 years, and by the time the first 6 months was over, we would feel we knew this everything about this room. We would understand the dynamics of this room totally, intimately. But if we left this room, we'd be lost. And that's the thing about our culture. It makes us smart. It turns us into smart arses. But once we go outside the narrow limits of the culture that we've of our smart arsery, we're lost. And that's what I say. When you get to the point of alcoholism, addiction, when you've lost everything, when you're on the edge of the abyss, these concepts are no use. This has been my experience. And there are different kinds of knowledge. You can rumble God and you can read all of these guys' books, and I have. And it's great. They're very interesting. Even when I disagree with them, they're still interesting. We need them. But they don't answer the need that I have. They don't actually explain the fundamental problem that I wake up with every morning. It's not a problem in a way, but it's a question. A problem in the mathematical sense almost. And this problem is this. I do not make myself. I do not make myself. Who am I? I call myself John Waters because that was the name that was given to me. I say this is my nose, this is my face. What does this mean? It means nothing. It is not my face. I didn't make it. I didn't give myself at it. I wasn't even at any of the meetings at which all this was discussed. Don't we all have these questions? These are the questions. The only place that these questions are addressed is through what we call religion. And the only word which captures in any sense, poetic or whatever you want to call it, the meaning of all this is the word God. I cannot live without this word and what it might mean to me. I don't think anybody. And a society which thinks it can is deluded. Because we talk about this now, we move on, modern, 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 progress, progress, progress. But we are still parasitic upon St. Paul's. When St. Paul's is demolished, everything we take for granted is dead and will not be risen again. Thank you.
Thank you, John. Well, that's some differing perspectives on this question for us to ponder.
You've forgotten me again.
Tell them. I'm not trying to squeeze you out of this, Dolan.
So, what's Dolan got to do with it?
Sorry.
Like Ken, I'm a Presbyterian by christening. I would say rather atheist by tradition, because I really have no commitment at all to the proposition that there's no God. Why would I? But I want to start with my favourite Christian joke. It's about a young man who's at a crossroads in his life, and he decides to consult the Bible for some guidance. So he opens it at random and finds the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 27, verse 5, which tells him that Judas went and hanged himself. He thinks, well, it's not particularly helpful for me. I'll just flick on a bit further. He gets to Luke 10:37, and Jesus said to him, "You go and do likewise." I say it's a Christian joke rather than an anti-Christian joke, because really it's at the expense of a misguided Christian. I mean, after all, where do you get the idea that a random Bible verse is supposed to speak to you? It's not a biblical idea. It's not a church tradition particularly. You might as well look at animal entrails or tea leaves, like an honest pagan. Instead, as I understand it, authentic Christianity involves the use of reason as much as divine revelation. There's a whole tradition of natural law. And, you know, Paul says in the letter to Romans that all mankind has the law in his heart, that it's given by God. So this is an idea, even if you haven't become a Christian. So the Bible is something to be thought about, discussed with others, and even argued about. I think there's a long tradition of that within Christianity as well, and obviously in other religions too. And texts are discussed, interpreted, even though it's controversial. And actually, it's quite rare in moral debates to find someone asserting a moral argument based solely on scripture. It's one of the things we object to. Why should we do what's in your holy book? Actually, I find that religious people very rarely do that. If you ask a religious person why it's wrong to steal or kill, they generally won't feel the need to quote the holy book at you. Even when it comes to more contentious issues, like abortion or euthanasia, for example, there's typically an appeal to a more basic moral sense of the sanctity of life. And I think everyone gets that. You can understand where they're coming from without putting it down to religion, even if you don't accept that that sanctity of life overrides all other concerns. So there's a kind of rational appeal on a basic human level in most of these kinds of arguments. Where religion is explicitly invoked as a source of moral authority, funnily enough, I would call it kind of political correctness, because it usually comes from a reluctance to offend, and particularly in the case of homosexuality. So there have always been, until quite recent times, widely made non-religious, natural law-type arguments against homosexuality, you know, suggesting it's perverted or disordered in various ways. The problem with those arguments nowadays is that they're incredibly offensive to gay people. So nobody really wants to make those arguments in public without making themselves a pariah. It's a lot easier to say, look, it's nothing personal. We've got this holy book. And as far as homosexuality goes, holy book says no. Sorry, nothing we can do about it. Of course, that's a disingenuous argument. The fact that you're resorting to scripture, effectively blaming God for your unfashionable opinions, shows that you're not really making a serious moral argument at all. So I think it is objectionable, not just from the point of view of a secular audience who doesn't share the same beliefs, but even within the terms of religion itself, it's not really acceptable just to fall back on it like that. And in the case of homosexuality, it's an indication that the traditional religious views become marginalized and its proponents are on the defensive. I think that's very clear. You people saying it's nothing personal, it's just our religion. Let's not talk about it. But that resort to scripture, I think, is not only disingenuous or defensive form of argument, it's one version of the appeal to authority. The same thing can happen with science, as I think Ken mentioned. For example, if you were to defend homosexuality by saying, well, there's a gay gene, or certain kinds of animals get involved in homosexual activity, so it must be all right. I mean, I think those are scientifically spurious, but anyway, kind of irrelevant to the morality of it. You might all say, what's science got to do with it? Moral questions should be dealt with in moral terms. But I think it's very difficult to get away from this yearning for something objective, some external authority to back up your arguments, especially when your arguments are contentious or difficult. And Ken mentioned facts and expertise being important, and of course they are. I think the problem arises when they're confused or used in disingenuous ways. For example, we know there was the big controversy during the referendum campaign about what the experts had to say, and Michael Gove famously said, people have had enough of experts. And of course, it would be wrong to say we're not interested in people who have demonstrable knowledge, who are able to tell us things that we don't know. I think the problem with that was that facts were often used to kind of bolster what was effectively a moral argument. I think for a lot of people, the EU whether we should be in the EU was a moral question about what kind of country we are, what kind of people we are. I think the people who wanted to remain felt that, and they felt that there was something very disreputable about the Leave campaign, that there was something xenophobic about it. And sometimes these arguments were had out, but I think often they were just hidden behind, here's a pile of facts, here's what the experts are saying, look at all these world leaders who are saying we should stay in the EU. And that was an appeal to authority. It wasn't, I think, a credible moral argument. Of course, the Leave side did it too. You know, they bolstered the moral argument for sovereignty by making up numbers about the NHS. I mean, that was also disingenuous. I think what was lacking was a more serious kind of moral argument about the merits or demerits of the EU and what Britain wants to represent. But it's almost a kind of, as I say, political correctness, a preface for being polite. If we make it just about the facts, then we don't have to insult anyone or get into contentious issues. So that's why I would make a kind of plea for what I call moral reasoning, which I think doesn't have to defer to scientific expertise. It can draw on that, of course. It doesn't have to defer to religious authority, even and perhaps especially if you are religious. I think it's far better to be able to argue on moral terms. I'm glad someone else brought up the Euthyphro problem, because I don't know how to pronounce it either. But that's something I think worth perhaps bringing in the discussion. But I do think there's this question of do we follow the facts because it's good to do so, or because the facts are correct? To what extent do facts actually direct us in terms of the decisions that we make that are moral? I think that it would be wrong to assume that simply being guided by the facts is in itself a moral act. But I think that's something that I hope will come out in the discussion.
Thank you, Dolan. You probably came along here thinking the discussion about God would be a Brexit-free zone, but no such luck. Can I just begin by putting a few sort of brief questions to the panel before coming out to the rest of the audience to get your views? If I could just ask you, Tim, and I mean, I was very interested in your argument. Obviously, these discussions about Dawkins and the new atheists have raged for some years, and I think your distinction between the issue of faith as a faith in a doctrine, people's belief in a particular doctrine, is the way in which the new atheists have polemicized against it, failing to see that religious faith is much more a commitment to something rather than a belief in a specific set of doctrines or anything. And so as a result of that, it rather passed by the people in favor of religion and people against it were talking across one another. But what I would just like to ask you about that is, given what seems a remarkable kind of emptiness of that discussion, why do you think it's had such impact? I mean, why is the Dawkins argument so popular? And why has it had such a widespread resonance, particularly among liberals who seem to have really taken it up, and almost a sort of identification with Dawkins is a, you know, what the right-thinking guardianista does these days.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thanks. That's a really good question. I'm not entirely sure. Something that Ken said, I think, explains some of it, and what people wanting to look for a general account or scapegoat for the problems of the world. I think that's something to do with it. But another thing, I think, is rather more cynically, I think that intellectuals sometimes think that they ought to try and change the world as opposed to just describe it. There is that whole tradition. And I think for a certain kind of intellectual, it's a very appealing thing to try and knock down people's, what they think of as people's belief in God. They think it's an easy shot. You know, Dawkins does it in his book. He goes through the arguments that people learn in first year philosophy against the existence of God. So I think there's a sort of way in which the intellectuals miss the point by thinking that this is all about theoretical arguments. Whereas, of course, no one who believes because of any of these arguments for the existence of God. But it's completely irrelevant to them. So.
Thank you. Perhaps follow that on with you, Ken, because you also raised this question, and particularly you trace the origins of the new atheism to the 2000-2001 sort of moment. And in particular, you know, you made the point about the challenge to scientists of what appeared to be anti-scientific arguments, creationism, etc., coming from the fundamentalist Christian movement in the States. I remember reading Dawkins' book and being struck by, he got the example of Peter Vardy, who was this millionaire who bankrolled an academy school in Gateshead or somewhere. But what really struck me, he was the only person that promoted the idea of, and it didn't even actually happen in practice, of creationism in English schools. I strongly suspect that it's a highly exaggerated phenomenon in the States, but it's certainly non-existent in Britain, this particular challenge to scientific principle. And in fact, you could discover much more significant challenges to scientific thinking. And so, for example, an area that occurred to me in that same period was the rising influence of alternative health schools. So you had universities promoting courses in homeopathy and acupuncture. The Oxford professor of scientific understanding didn't seem to find that threatening, but was threatened by rather what seemed to be a not very significant challenge from creationism.
Speaking as a former creationist, let's do the identity politics thing. As a recovered creationist, I think that certainly in the United States, it is a serious issue because it appears in state after state after state. It affects what can go into biology, high school biology textbooks, because the most conservative states have the veto on what can go into the widely published textbooks. And there is a great gap in the scientific education of most American high schoolers. Now, whether that's important or not is a matter for Americans, but there are very many scientists and science educators in the United States who can give you chapter and verse, if you like, on the problems that this creates for them. And in British schools, it's more widespread than we like to think. One of my former tutors in zoology, in fact, Dr. Richard Downey from Glasgow University, did a survey on the students that were coming into his course in biology and zoology and medicine, and found that about a third of them were convinced creationists, whether it was from a Christian or a Muslim background. And some of them had got this in faith schools of one kind or another. Now, I don't say that's not, however, the major reason. I think it was the convergence of, first of all, it was 9/11, and then there was the fact that George W. Bush did all this talking about faith and faith-based initiatives, and he wasn't a particularly militant crusader for Christianity in the United States, but he did appeal to that particular voting bloc, and I think that caused worries among a certain section of the liberal intelligentsia in the US. And these books like Dawkins, Harris, and the rest really took off. Does that answer that?
Yeah, I think that's helpful. Yeah, thank you.
Sorry. Just turning now to Mona, who I think presented a somewhat wider discussion of the role of religion in people's lives in modern society, and the whole issue of how the religion offers hope and consolation for human beings in relation to a lot of areas of their lives which are not actually helped much by politics or other things, for the experiences of suffering and loss and ultimately death. These are profound existential experiences which everybody has to engage with, and which people find tremendous solace and comfort in religion in helping them deal with. But obviously the issue that then arises is, given that the sphere of faith in the proportion of people in society who cleave to these beliefs and values is declining, what contribution can religion make to the rest of society who don't share these convictions? And that's particularly in the context that many people have an experience and perceive the role of organized religion in their lives in a way which actually curtails their humanity, in terms of religion has often in many societies, and in some respects in continuing in this one, is associated with various sorts of intolerance, some of which Dolan mentioned. It's associated with the restrictions on women's rights around abortion and contraception, embargoes against divorce, homosexuality, etc. How do you respond to that challenge?
Well, I don't think we can actually get away from the fact that at least in most of the West, I mean Western Europe as well as North America, our language has been that of individual human rights and liberal freedoms for the last couple of hundred years. And that is a really seductive language. And people have bought into that because it offers them hope as well in their lives. So whether you're gay, whether you want an abortion, or whether you're a woman who's looking for more equality in the workplace or in life in general, this language of human rights offers you a way in. But hasn't stopped people necessarily thinking that even though some of the consequences of the human rights language may clash with traditional religious practice and orthodoxy, people who have religious faith, most of them, I'm not talking about the fundamentalists, we can go on to them later, but most people kind of live with those twin things. They buy into the human rights language because it offers hope in a different way, but they want to hold on to God as well because God offers another kind of hope. And I think if we just even scratch the surface of history, whether it's Islamic or Christian or Jewish, we'll see that some of the biggest intellects of the histories of these world religions have wrestled with what does it mean to believe in God. But our public debates about religion in public life are so bad. They're constantly polarizing atheism with religion or secularity with religion, as if somehow people are a constant angst when they wake up in the morning, oh, how do I live my religion today? They're not. And that's partly because the West has had, the language of liberal rights in the West has been so seductive and such a good context for human rights. Having said all that, I think the backlash against human rights is an interesting phenomenon. Philosophically as well as socially, that human rights is, on the one hand, is this ideal that allows you to be whoever you are, and yet we're still searching for something else. Even if we can be whoever we want to be, it's still not enough. So my interest when I talk about public religion is really how do people live with those kind of tensions, as opposed to, you know, how do religious people get their voice across? They don't come across saying, I'm religious, so my voice will be different. They just say, you know, this is what God means in my life, but I'm part of this wider society.
Thank you. It's been very difficult pursuing that because of the sheer theological illiteracy of the whole Dawkins school of country, because it's so far bypasses a lot of these fundamental issues and doesn't even sort of recognise them. Just turning to John, I mean, your personal testimony was very powerful, but it does raise the question of, you know, if your experience of, you know, you experience a sort of moment of truth, in a sense, in your relationship with alcohol, was your discovery of God another evasion of the harsh confrontation with reality in the same way that alcohol was? And in the sense that people say that religion provides an escape, an evasion, an illusory compensation for the realities of you know, facing realities of a harsh world in the face. And yeah, that's I'll leave it.
Well, that's a very interesting question, because that's exactly what my prejudice was at that moment when I went into Alcoholics Anonymous. And what I thought was being presented to me with all this talk about God was simply that, you know, a prognosis along these lines, that look, you've front-loaded your fun. It's all over. Now you better get on your knees, boy, and just pray out the rest of your life, you know? And that didn't sound like much fun. And I began to see, actually, because I had no choices, really. I was desperate, so I hung around and listened to this stuff. And eventually, stuff began to penetrate the fog, and I realized this word God was being used in a very particular way that I'd never heard it being used like this before. And I became to realize that actually it wasn't really about God, it was about me, that it was about my structure, that I had a given structure, that I didn't generate my structure, that my structure wasn't arbitrary, and that therefore that structure had a particular way that it worked in the world, and that I had, in a sense, I had defiled that, not necessarily in a moral way, well, although that as well, but in a functional way, that I had actually exceeded the limits of my given structure. And once I began to see myself in this way, I started to kind of do a process which they offer to me as fake it till you make it. So in other words, I literally pretended to believe, and I pretended to pray, and I observed the results, being completely skeptical about them. And I actually observed that my life changed. Now, I can only say to you, and I don't see this in any supernatural sense, I don't understand it, but I do say to you that this happened. And I say to you that I've learned from this experience that there are different kinds of intelligence, and that there are different kinds of knowledge and different kinds of facts. And the experience, that the knowledge of experience is just as valid. If something happens in your life that you don't understand, that you are skeptical about, that you are, you know, maybe a little bit scathing about privately, but it nevertheless happens, you have to concede that, because that's the truth. And that there's a difference there between fact and truth. And that's something I've never seen addressed in any of these discussions. You know, I'm actually, in a certain sense, a reluctant believer, in the sense that, in terms of my image, my self-image through many years, I have always felt that when I talk about religion, I always feel embarrassed, because it doesn't seem, because there are so many misunderstandings about it. And I don't want, and of course you can't avoid being associated with everything that is in religion or associated with it. But my point is, I come to this in spite of myself. In spite of myself.
Thank you, John. I won't forget you now, Dolan. I mean, I suppose, responding to your introduction, I mean, the problem seemed to start where you finished, which is that if we can no longer look for us as a source of moral authority to the scriptures, or, as you say, to science, where do we start?
I think we start with the tradition. I mean, there is, religious and otherwise, a tradition of moral thought that we all, to some extent, believe in. I think even when people challenge particular moral precepts, they do so with reference to other moral precepts that have a long legacy. It's what C.S. Lewis called the Tao, this idea of accumulated wisdom in different traditions and so on, and which doesn't depend on any particular religious faith. And I do think it does involve having a certain respect for tradition, which is perhaps unfashionable, And for thinking, having an assumption that traditions might be worth respecting until shown otherwise. And that, you know, that includes, that can, you know, can include quite radical political thought, deferring back to particular traditions. I think the problem starts when people try to justify every moral precept from scratch. I don't think it's a sensible thing to do. There are certain things that you can't really challenge without just being a bit crazy. You certainly should question things with reference to, but you can only do it with reference to other moral precepts. You can't step outside of the human tradition of morality. So I think you have to be not worried about seeming a bit conservative in terms of deferring to tradition, because if you're really going to challenge it effectively, you need to have some kind of grounding.
Okay, thanks, Dolan. Thanks to all the speakers up to now. So now we'll go out to the floor. So,
hello. I just had a question for the panelists. We're discussing religion here and belief, and belief in God specifically, generally. It's so hard to define religion. I definitely agree with that, what many of the panelists have said. And this raises the question in the end. I mean, of course, it makes sense to discuss religion, religious traditions, and specific categories of traditions, and being very clear about what you're talking about. But in a kind of practical sense, in society, do you feel... I'm asking the panelists, do you feel that when something is associated with religion, or when someone says, this is my religion, or this is part of a religious tradition or anything, do you feel it has a special significance? Does this add anything to the specific practice, tradition, belief, ritual, whatever it is? Should we treat those things differently from any other new belief, for example, new practice, new ritual, or ideology, or whatever that might not be defined as religious, but has many parallels?
I'm interested particularly in this question of a secular public space. Do you think that we can square two perhaps superficially conflicting demands? The first is for our secular space, our public space, to be secular, and the second is for people to be much more upfront and much more honest, I suppose, and not disingenuous in appealing to their religious convictions where they want to. And is there a squeamishness about religious people, as it were, being openly religious in the public sphere? And if so, should we be happy with that as secularists, or should we do more to still insist that they should wear their religion publicly as well?
I see science as on a trajectory at the moment, and that trajectory is that at some point in the future we'll be able to recreate a person from a previously recorded state. Essentially, we have invented reincarnation. We might actually reincarnate people into virtual worlds that are perfect for them, effectively maybe creating heaven. At that point, it raises a few interesting questions. Death
certainly does.
Death is essentially a state of consciousness. Heaven, we will know whether it exists or not. We might even, based on ethics, decide who we want to reincarnate and who we don't. Even in the future, a future civilization might even be able to go back in time and reincarnate Mozart, might be able to reincarnate anybody in this room. So my question is basically, do I hold religious views there, or is this scientific prediction, and where does God sit in there?
My question to the lady on my left, I'm sorry, I don't remember your name.
Oh, no.
It's rather, do you not think that, well, I think that God and religion is just social constructs, and rather than a force in the universe influencing people, it's rather just people influencing themselves and then saying, well, this must be God. That would be my question to you. And then to John would be your idea about certain situations you can't necessarily explain through rational ideas, and saying that there must be some kind of higher power or higher thought. Do you not then risk falling into the God of the gaps delusion?
Just a couple of comments. One to Tim about the distinction between belief and practice. I mean, I fully agree with you that it, you know, religion has a lot to do with belonging. But I don't think you can get rid of the belief aspect. And I think that comes out very strongly with John's story, because there's a rescue story going on there. At least that's the way I hear it. And, you know, you can't have a rescue story without a rescuer as well as the person being rescued.
God is a social construct.
people say gender is a social construct. Everything could be a social construct. I think for me, the important thing is, many philosophers have said this, many religious people have said this, that just as much as God is a product of our loneliness, we are a product of God's loneliness. We are a product of God's loneliness, God is a product of our loneliness. People have defined God in all kinds of ways. But for me, the most, when you strip religion of all its doctrine, of all its creeds, of all its practice, something within many of us, not all of us, something within many of us is still left searching, longing, whether you call that God, whether you buy into the doctrines and the practices. I would also say that the rise of fundamentalisms is a worrying thing for many people, but we should question why is there a rise of fundamentalism, at least in the Abrahamic traditions. What is it about religious conviction that appeals to people? And you could say, well, it's a political construct, it's in reaction to what people call religious social relativism, all kinds of things. But why are people returning to religion in a way, in as much as people are turning away? What is causing that kind of paradigm shift? Secular public space, I think that secularism can be defined in so many ways, and Western Europe has its own ways of thinking about secularism. I find it difficult. Baroness Warnock once said that she would not take her faith into her debates. I don't see how you can completely absolve yourself of your deepest... Now, you could argue, what is your deepest conviction? Is my deepest conviction going to go against state regulation or state rulings and lots of things? Probably not, because I have bought into the fundamental thing, which I think religious doctrine doesn't provide for many people, even though it talks about human dignity, which is equality under the law. And the state does provide that. Whether it lives up to that, I don't know. But I think when you buy into that, then you have to respect that there is some things called the public opinion, there is public sway, there is contextual moral theology, and that you have to think about where... You have to rethink what you believe. You have to, not necessarily doctrines, but a kind of public moral space. The only thing I would say, though, is that I think because it's become so difficult, whether it's through social media, for people to actually say what they really mean in public life, a lot of the time we are just throat clearing. A lot of us never really express fully what we want to, because if you have total conviction about something, you're often branded as something as not completely wacky, but you're not in that part of the liberal milieu. And everybody wants to be part of that, because if you're not, you're ostracized. And I think that's a detriment to our public debate, that we've created in the guise of religious freedom, in the guise of freedom of expression, we're actually not allowing people to be free to express what they want.
Yes, I'd just like to say something to the gentleman here who commented on the distinction between belief and practice. Absolutely, I agree with you. I didn't want to say that religion was all about just practice and going to church, and that there was no element of a belief in something else. What I think is that the belief in the transcendent, of something that goes beyond all the world of experience, is not quite what the new atheists think it is. They think of it as much more like, you know, a conjecture or a hypothesis that explains the world. It's much more like something that actually John was bringing up in his talk, which is the sense of the mystery that lies at the heart of the world, and that the world is fundamentally unintelligible to us. And I think that's something which I think is not part of the secular sort of materialist worldview. That part of that worldview is that the world should be intelligible to us. So I think that's a huge divide between what's come from since the Enlightenment to now, as opposed to the religious vision of the world. If I could just say something about the question of the secular state, and what that should be, what it should be disclosing or exposing. I think here I want to agree with something that Dolan said, which is that we start with our traditions, and of course we criticize our traditions too. But we have to identify what's good in our traditions and start from there. And I think this country actually does have a tradition of religious tolerance going back to the 17th century. It also has a tradition of religious intolerance. But we should try and preserve. That's part of what we should try and preserve if we are. And we're not a secular state in the way that France is a secular state. I think we should try and preserve the tradition of tolerance. And tolerance does not mean admiring other views or saying all views are equally valuable. You can only really tolerate those things that you object to. So we should tolerate those and try to, because we need to live in peace with people. That's the essence of it.
John?
I'd like to start with this idea of the God of the Gaps delusion. No, because it isn't so much, it isn't at all that what I'm talking about mystery is, you know, the parts of reality we don't understand. It's that there are two different ways of comprehending reality. One is the one we use every day in this box in which we live. And where the delusion creeps in is the idea that in this there might be, when we spot a gap, that we will fill it with something. I'm talking about what is the totality of everything beyond this box, which is virtually everything, if not everything, if not more than everything. And that's where the problem sets in. Joseph Ratzinger talked about this in terms of the bunker that man has built for himself to live in which he has shut out the mystery. And by shutting the mystery of the universe out, we also do something else. We try to shut in the mystery of ourselves. And that's the fundamental error we make as human beings. And you see now the consequences. Already we can see the consequences. You know, a post-religious society is essentially a medicated society. That's the future. Because we cannot deal with our mysteriousness in a world we cannot comprehend without chemical assistance. That is the picture that is emerging.
Speak for yourself.
Well, you see, you're still in the slipstream of a religious civilization, Michael. So you're not a good case study. You see, this is the point. You know, for us to disprove this, by the time we actually can prove all this, it'll be too late, because we will have dismantled the civilization on which we depend, and then we're in real trouble. We will then say, we shouldn't have done that. It's like that guy in Harry Enfield said, I don't think you wanted to do that. You know, and that's where we're going, because we're like chimpanzees over the engine of a Maserati with lump hammers. We haven't the faintest idea how it's put together, but we're determined to fix it no matter what. The sci-fi thing. Because I think this is a very important point here. But all that stuff, I don't know. I mean, who knows what's going to happen? But my hunch is that we're going to destroy ourselves because of our inability to develop ethically at the same parallel to our scientific development. But what you get to is a really important point, that a lot of our understandings of religion are of necessity archaic. You know, our imagery is archaic. You know, there's a sort of sense in Ireland, like, you know, that there's an image of almost that when you die, you will sort of float up through the air and end up at a dining table with the Holy Family for dinner. And they'll sort of introduce you to the new life that you're going to live. And I mean, that's not too far from what actually, if you really investigated people's beliefs. But I think that actually when you get into, all this kind of, what do you call this new physics stuff, quantum physics and things, you actually begin to see things like the idea of consciousness leaching off after death and all this kind of stuff that nobody ever dreamt of. So the meanings of what we actually understand religiously may actually turn out to be metaphors for an entirely different kind of reality. And you're right, maybe that will be religion, maybe that will be heaven, maybe that will be what we have been talking about for all these years.
Or maybe not.
Or maybe.
Ken.
Yeah. Well, just to try and take another take on the science, this scientific reincarnation idea, following on from what John was saying, to reply to that, I, as a science fiction writer, I've used that scenario far too many times, right? Let's say, and as a former scientist, a lapsed scientist, an unfrocked scientist, I can say that it's pretty unlikely in any remotely foreseeable future. I've given a talk at the Institute of Ideas' other big event, the Academy, which I'd highly recommend to anyone who can do, and not my talk, the event, the summer school, as a brilliantly intellectually stimulating thing. And I am very, very skeptical about whether that is feasible in, you know, even with even if we assume another 1,000 years of more or less uninterrupted scientific progress. I could be wrong about that. I hope I'm wrong about that, kind of, because I'd love to be reincarnated into an enjoyable simulation of one kind or another. Now, is indulging that speculation the same thing as having a religious belief? Well, I don't think it is. And I think that it shows up. It shows one of the differences between scientific speculation, however wacky, and religious belief, however sober, which is that the religious beliefs are held in a very different way to scientific beliefs, as Tim has pointed out. But one of the things I would like to sort of connect with that and come back to is the supposed theological lack of sophistication of the new atheists, because now there's some truth in that, obviously, but I have been in these trenches myself, and I can tell you that the kind of fights that they're waging are against people who are just as theologically unsophisticated. The fundamentalists, in the Christian fundamentalists, most certainly and most sincerely believe in the book of Genesis as a scientific hypothesis that, you know, you can actually prove. They have obviously a subjective religious commitment, some often a very deep one, but they also entertain it as a hypothesis. And no wonder it drives liberal theologians bonkers to find people argue about the size of Noah's Ark, you know? What? But nevertheless, they do, and if you want to get down in that mud and argue with and roll around in the mud like that, then that's what's going to happen. But as far as a lot of people are concerned, it really is geology or God, conventional geology, scientific geology or God, and they hold that these geological hypotheses about geology, often very specific hypotheses, with incredible tenacity, or some of them do. Quite often people can get argued out of them, and it tends to be that people who get argued out of that kind of position don't move over to Anglicanism or whatever. They just go straight to atheism.
Yeah, I'll just briefly pick up on the secularism idea and whether religious ideas are kind of have a special status. I think that secularism has to involve a heavy assumption in favor of religious toleration of different practices. If you take an example like circumcision, male circumcision of babies, if someone invented that now, out of nowhere, you would think this is very strange. And I think perhaps you would think it was a matter for social workers and perhaps even the police. You would think, well, why are these people deforming their children like this? And from a strictly rational point of view, the fact that it's been practiced in two of the world's great religions for thousands of years is irrelevant. I think in the real world, it's extremely relevant. It makes a huge difference. People say, well, this is a symbol of welcoming this baby into our community. It's done in love rather than out of spite or just weirdness. I think we have to say, well, okay then. It's not strictly rational, but that's fine. And actually, it's the kind of militant secularists who want to say that that's child abuse, who end up looking like religious fanatics, because they've, you know, taken this idea of bodily integrity and elevated it to such an extent that it jars with real human culture. Obviously, female circumcision is different. We feel that seems to be more harmful. I think most of us would say that it's wrong, but we don't think it's so bad that we should invade the countries where it's practiced and stamp it out. You know, and I don't think we should be hyper policing immigrant communities where it might be practiced. I think there's a danger of that. So we can recognise that actually, unlike male circumcision, might be a problem, not to be tolerated in the same kind of a way. But we don't get fanatical about it. We have to have a kind of reasoned approach to these things.
Okay, we've got time for another round of questions.
Hi, I have a Hindu friend. She diligently follows the puja, she goes to the temple, she follows the prescribed diets of centuries of tradition. But I asked her, do you believe in any gods? And she answered, no. Now, this has posed a lot of tricky questions, I think. You can ask the question, is she religious? And whether you say yes or no, neither seems quite honest. So, following on from that, I think the concept of religion is very hazy and amorphous now and has kind of outlived its usefulness. Perhaps if we talked instead of deep-seated allegiance to a cultural tradition, it might be make a lot more sense of the behaviour we see around the world, like religious arguments against abortion. Then the more honest answer a Catholic or Muslim might make is it's against tradition, rather than trying to make some hazy reference to authority in ancient texts.
My question's for John Waters. I was very interested, you're a lapsed agnostic. I think I'm a lapsing agnostic. And I think where I've got to, and I'm just really going to ask for your comments on this, I think I feel that, I suppose my observations of what goes on and what I feel to be good and what I feel to be bad, I feel that on the good side, you have the spirit of creation, spirit of love and spirit of goodness, but getting beyond that to sort of personalising, because it seems to me that the idea of God is of a figure, almost has a sort of human, well, it's the idea of God the Father, etc. And I just wondered if he's got any comments on that.
Lots of non-religious people choose to mark key moments in their life with a religious ceremony, marriage, funerals. Do you think that is to their benefit or and to the benefit of the religion for the ceremony?
It certainly keeps the churches going, doesn't it?
My question's kind of related to that. I just wanted to explore a little bit of why you think some people are religious and why some people aren't. So if you think it's like a kind of yearning of the human condition to think above ourselves, I'm interested why some people seem more susceptible to that and why some people don't. Is that a lacking of, like, is there like a superiority in one belief rather than another? I'm just interested in what you thought.
The general consensus I've found, like, talking to different people about religion is that science will always offer, like, mechanical explanations, whereas religion will offer, like, a sort of purpose or why. I find myself agnostic because, though I was raised, like, strict Shia Muslim, I'm agnostic now because when I delved into Shiism, I found religion doesn't actually offer a why. It's called faith for a reason, because at the end of it, when you go through all the doctrine, all the reasons for the practices, you still have to believe sort of blindly. And I just think that when lots of people come to that realization, they sort of realize how outdated religion actually has become, and I'm just wondering what the panelists think on that are.
It was mentioned earlier on that a lot of liberals follow new atheism, particularly, I think it was by Tim. And I thought it was important to notice that John also mentioned, do you not think it's actually incredibly damaging to your own argument, to your own point, when you put it on the floor? And not to directly defend him, but I have to. Richard Dawkins, the world's most forefront evolutionary biologist, being dismissed as a smart ass. I think that's incredibly damaging to the discussion. And incredibly damaging to your own point. You might.
Thank you. Very last point.
Well, very quickly, in the words of that great philosopher Eminem, "I am whatever I say I am." And it's striking, the question of the I and what we think of God. And in the last century in America, the whole relationship of Christianity to the individual has changed, and we've become more and more obsessed with the I and not the we. And my question to the panel is what we think about God often what we think about people in some ways? Because, you know, the relationship between where we went from Rome to here and pre-Rome to here, in terms of the chronology of how we couldn't have got politics without religion, and it's been stated already, but also the fact that now people are exhausted with religion and politics. My question to you, particularly to John, is this: if we are not God, and that's the problem with civilization, and yet it's the imagination that is God, surely that's contradictory. And surely if we have a higher sense of ourselves and one another, can we do the moral reasoning that Dolan's talking about between religions and secular community and really come up with some new notions of the I and the we?
I start with Hinduism. I went to India 7 years ago and been fascinated ever since. I've been several times. I keep up with Indian politics and Indian culture. And I don't have a clue what Hinduism is all about. It's extremely mysterious religion. And
yeah, from a Catholic point of view, it's more understandable.
Well, yes, it's kind of like Catholicism on acid. It's something that obviously millions of people take very seriously, and it does seem to be a practice rather than a belief. I don't think that many Hindus have a personal belief in Krishna or Ganapati in a way that Christians believe in Jesus or Muslims believe in Allah. But nonetheless, it structures their lives. It's probably the closest thing we could think of something like classical religion in ancient Greece and Rome, where there's a set of traditions not necessarily associated with God, but which does sometimes sound a lot like monotheism, in fact. Some Hindus insist that Hinduism is monotheistic. So it's a useful kind of corrective to understand that religion takes lots of different forms. Just the other thing I wanted to pick up on was this question of non-religious people going to church, and people talk about hatch, match, and dispatch. That's christenings, weddings, and funerals. I think people obviously find some value in it. A lot of people like a church wedding in particular, and there's a debate within the church about whether it's a good thing or not. I think the consensus in the church, particularly in the Church of England, because it's established, it's part of its establishment, that it involves people who aren't particularly religious. I think from a more kind of evangelical point of view, then they should at least be exploiting it to make people proper Christians rather than just having them in and out, and out the door. So I'd say it's probably, in my view, probably not as good for the church as it is for the people who take advantage of it.
Just to very briefly, the point about God as a human figure, I mean, we have limited imaginations in the sense that we have to use certain kind of formats to get to, you know, so to put a face on God is not a bad thing in the sense that if it allows us to move past this dimension and find a technique to do that. The first question about your Hindu friend, do you believe, and I thought it was very interesting, and I agree with that, you know, the distance between those who believe in God and those who don't believe in God, or say they don't, may be very, very slight. And I think that's the point that we often miss with a lot of these discussions, that we have the same questions. We just use different formulations to arrive at certain ideas. And then these ideas become sclerotic. They're hardened within us. So to say, I am this, you are that. Whereas we have this, if we kind of go back to the questions, we might find that we all actually have very much a lot of common ground. The question about, and this goes to the point about the gentleman up there, but you know, it's a very good one, but why can't we extend our imagination and simply let that be it? The problem with that is that to create a collective human imagination which is on the same page in any sense, whether that would be a good thing or not is a different question, but even if it were, the problem with that is that what tends to happen in human culture is that certain, not all men, not all humans get to be part of it, certain men, certain humans start to lead this, and that becomes the problem. That the idea of us becoming God begins that certain men or certain women or certain men and women will become God, and that's not a good thing. Just on the Richard Dawkins thing, I just want to say this. I meant it as a compliment, because Richard Dawkins actually made one very good joke in his life, at least. I'm not saying he didn't make more, but when he said that, when he was talking about the crime of blasphemy, he said it was a victimless crime.
Just to the lady about why do some people believe or not. When my boys were at school and they went to a nice school, the one thing that their friends would always talk to them about is, why do you believe in anything? Religion only stops you from having fun. Religion only stops you from being who you are. And there were no easy answers to that, as to why some people feel that religion is a constrictive force rather than a constructive. But I think that I think sometimes we make the mistake in thinking that once we've seen the light, then we'll start believing. And belief isn't really about that. And it feeds into that sometimes you belong to and you practice certain traditions as a way into something. A Jewish friend of mine once said that his son had said to him, he would come home for Shabbat, but one day his son said, I think, Dad, I've actually stopped believing in God. And he said, I don't effing all care if you believe in God. You're doing Shabbat. As if somehow, even having that construct in which you can find an access to God, whether you believe deep down, will ultimately get you there. And I think for people who believe, there's a sense of loss if they feel that they'll wake up one day without a belief. And it's very hard to encapsulate that in rational terms, really.
I think that the question of religion without belief is a very interesting one, because for a start, it's quite parochial for us to think about religions in terms of beliefs. At least half, I would guess, of the 6 billion people who identify with religions in the world are identified with religions that don't have the Abrahamic God or any kind of single God, or the God of monotheism. I mean, and quite often no God at all, like Confucianism and Buddhism, in their more, certainly their more basic forms, don't have a belief in a God. So, and Hinduism, well, as Dolan said, it's quite hard to know what they believe. But one of the things that has struck me is that what we call belief may itself be simply another religious practice. Because someone says they're a believer and they will recite a creed or a phrase from the creed, But actually, as they would be the first to admit, they don't actually know what it means. What the mystical version that John is giving him very eloquently and, you know, movingly is in fact what any serious theologian would tell you when they recite the creed. Do they know what it means to say these words? No, they don't. And neither do I, and neither do we. So I think we should take this question of belief slightly warily and gently, and you know, certainly not push our neighbours too hard on it. That's it.
Okay, Tim.
Just a very brief comment on Richard Dawkins. I think that no one's questioning his ability or achievements as a biologist. But the good thing about a culture of rational debate is that we don't take things on authority. And I'm not going to take Richard Dawkins' views on authority, about his views on religion, on the authority of his experience as a biologist. Just finally, on the question of defining religion, which I think is something we've been skirting round a bit, and the very important point about Hinduism, I think Nietzsche said that only that which has no history can be defined. So since the history of humanity is the history of religion to a large extent, then religion in that sense can't be strictly defined. We're not really looking for some sort of sharp definition. But what I think there is among all the great religions of the world, the things that unite the 6 billion people, if it's possible to generalize at all, is this response to the mystery of the world and the sense of the world as being not intelligible to us, and the urge for something that transcends this ordinary world, which I think is there in Hinduism as well as in the monotheistic religions.
Thank you. Can we thank all our speakers? May God be with you all if he exists.